So let's talk about sets. That's sets with a T. Meaning can be a tricky thing to track down, even for your average noun or adjective. Sure, it's easy enough for names like Fox Mulder or Walter Skinner, but what about words like alien or conspiracy or descriptions like mysterious or supernatural? Not to mention how we put these meanings together when we make sentences. Luckily, linguists have picked up the flashlight of set theory and used it to peer around the dark corners of language. I'm Moti Lieberman, and this is the Ling Space.
Welcome to the Ling Space.
If you've watched our semantics videos, you already know that linguists have borrowed a whole lot from philosophy. It's given us some tools to work out what individual words contribute to the overall meaning of a sentence. In particular, logic is really useful when talking about connective words like and or. And it also comes pretty handy when talking about quantifiers, like some and all. But we haven't really gotten our hands dirty with things like nouns and adjectives yet, and to do them justice, we're going to have to get a bit mathy. And there's one branch of mathematics that linguists have found pretty darn useful, set theory. Set theory is the study of sets, or collections, and how they relate to and interact with each other. It was founded in the late 19th century by German mathematician Georg Cantor, and it's gone through a lot of changes since. But to uncover just how it helps us talk about meaning, we'll go through some of the most basic ideas, and then we'll try applying them to English to see what happens. The most fundamental concept underlying all of set theory is, well, the set. A set is any collection of things. And those things can be concrete, like people or planets, but they can also be abstract, like numbers and shapes. To represent sets, we can list all of the items we want in them, and then close them up with curly brackets. So, for example, if we've identified three conspiracy theorists and we want to build a set with them, we could just list their names and then close it up. For very big sets, where it gets too cumbersome to list every single thing in it, we can just be lazy and describe the contents instead. So if we wanted to collect together everyone who works for the government, we could write this. This can be read as the set of all things X such that X works for the government. And to be even lazier, we can give our sets names for when we want to refer back to them. Like, we could call the set we just made W for works. Or, we could collect together all of the FBI's special agents and call that set A for agent. This makes each group easier to talk about later. Another fundamental concept is the idea of something being a member of some set. Like, we know that Dana Scully is a special agent, and so we know that she belongs to the set A. To represent this relationship in terms of set theory, we write that Dana Scully is an element of A, like so. That E-shaped trident symbol means that whatever's to the left can be found inside of the set on the right. And speaking of relationships, another important connection in set theory is the subset relation. We use this one when we find one set forming a part of another one, even if just abstractly. To put it another way, we say that one set is a subset of another just so long as everything in the first one is also in the second. We write this relationship out as a kind of turned U. So, if the set of special agents at the FBI is a subset of all the people who work in the government, we get this. Or, to shorten things, we can use the names we've given these sets in place of their descriptions and write the same relationship out as this. We can even draw a picture of what's going on. Here, you can see that the set of all special agents is a subset of all government employees, because the circle standing in for the special agents is totally inside the circle standing in for every government worker. That bigger set includes special agents, but also diplomats and postal workers and everyone else. And we can do more than just relate sets to each other, we can manipulate them too. If we wanted the set of all cigarette-smoking men, we could just build it by taking the overlap between the set of all smokers and the set of all men. This operation is known as intersection, and we would write it out in symbols using an upside-down U like this. We could also combine the whole of these two sets, which is kind of like set theory's version of addition. If we take all the smokers and all the men together, we get a group that's bigger than either set by itself, since it includes cigarette-smoking men, but also other cigarette smokers and non-smoking men too. In set-theoretic terms, this can be written out with the plain U, for union. Finally, we can use the tools of set theory to count the number of things in a set. To do this, we just sandwich it in between two vertical bars. Like, if we wanted to count how many conspiracy theorists we had before, we would just write this. The number of elements inside of a set is called the set's cardinality, and in case you are wondering, it can be any number between 0 and infinity. It can even be 0, since we could just write two curly brackets with nothing in between them and call it the empty set. Spooky. With the basics of set theory out of the way, we can already start seeing some pretty interesting things going on in language that we might not have noticed before. Like, adjectives can actually be broken up into a few categories depending on their set theoretic characteristics. For starters, if we keep treating adjectives and nouns as sets like we've been doing throughout this episode, some adjectives seem to behave intersectively. That means that some adjectives, when they combine with nouns, give you the intersection of those two sets. Words like extraterrestrial, carnivorous, and gray work this way. Since an extraterrestrial creature is something that's both from outer space and a creature, the meaning is fairly balanced between the two words. But other adjectives can behave non-intersectively. In fact, this is true of most adjectives. Words like brilliant and tall and famous are all defined relative to the set of nouns they're modifying. A brilliant pilot isn't necessarily brilliant overall, and it definitely doesn't mean they're a brilliant doctor. They could be a terrible doctor. And a tall agent who plays basketball isn't necessarily also tall for a basketball player. They could be really short relative to that set. We can't really treat words like fast or tall as referring to independent sets on their own. Instead, they're always kind of inside or part of the set associated with the noun. In other words, nouns with these kinds of adjectives are always going to be subsets of the noun. For this reason, these kinds of adjectives are sometimes called subsective, and the influence on overall meaning here is weighted much more towards the noun. All the way at the other end of things, we've got anti-intersective adjectives. These kinds of words almost totally ignore the noun that comes after them. We're talking about words like fake and imaginary and prefixes like x. After all, an imaginary monster is much more likely to be found in someone's head than under a bed. In these cases, we could say that the intersection of one of these adjectives with a noun is empty, since the set it creates has nothing in it. Finally, there are adjectives which don't bear much of a set-theoretic relationship with their nouns at all, and they don't really tell you anything about whether the noun in question is, well, the noun in question. Adjectives like alleged and potential and likely, when combined with a noun, kind of leave it open whether that noun is what it claims to be. An alleged shapeshifter might turn out to be human after all, or they might really be an alien in disguise. This kind of math is what's underneath our meanings. Subconsciously, it's how we make sense of the world, and we can do deeper and more intuitive semantics with sets, as we'll come back to talk about in the future. The interaction of adjectives and nouns is just one of the many realms where set theory can shine a light on how meanings of words come together to create meanings of larger expressions like phrases and sentences. And linguists will continue exploring these semantic mysteries. After all, the truth is out there. So we've reached the end of the Ling space for this week. If you collected all your elements together into a set, you learned that words can be grouped together according to their mathematical properties. That some adjectives combine with nouns in a straightforward, intersective way where the meaning contribution of each word is about the same. That the meanings of other adjectives are relative to, or even completely independent of, the noun they modify. And that the tools of set theory let us explore the semantics of words in novel and powerful ways. The Ling Space is produced by me, Moti Lieberman, and directed by Denise Favo. This week's episode was written by Stefan Hurtebees. Our editor is George Coulot, our music is by Shane Turner, and our graphics team is Atelier Views. We're down in the comments below. Or you can bring the discussion back over to our website, where we'll have some extra material on this topic. Check us out on Tumblr, Twitter, and Facebook, and try dropping by our store. And if you want to keep expanding your own personal Ling Space, please subscribe. And we'll see you next Wednesday. Arrivederci.